Let us pray. Our God, who reigns as King sovereignly above, and yet our God, who comes as kind Savior below, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we thank you for another chance to gather in your house to be your people. We do pray that at this time, when so much seems to be going wrong in our world, and so many are being caught up in some panic about this virus that's going around, we pray that we will not give in to fear, that we will not yield to temptation, to doubt your presence and your love and power in our lives. In all things, guide and keep us according to your will. Bless us now as we study your word, and help us as we consider once again whether we're your children or your enemies. In Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So that's the question we've been asking on Wednesday nights. Are you an enemy of Christ? Are your actions, are your attitudes, are your words that which would help someone to better see God? Or are what you're doing in your life influencing them or encouraging them or pointing them in a direction other than God? We look tonight at verses 23 and 24 of the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 23, printed on the back of your bulletin. Jesus said, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you tithe mint and dill and cumin, and have neglected the weightier provisions of the law, justice and mercy and faithfulness. But these are the things you should have done without neglecting the others. You blind guides who strain out a gnat and swallow a camel." What picturesque language. The Pharisees were all into the law, and they followed the law to the minutest detail. They would tithe of every little thing that they had. I mean, all these little spices and everything else. They were that concerned about obedience. But Jesus says, in all your obedience, you've missed out everything you should be taken into account of. Have you ever been to a church where there's more law than gospel? Have you ever run across a preacher that's more about rules and regulations than he is about redemption and forgiveness? Growing up in college, I always like to be, try to be involved in churches and try to, can I be a youth minister at your church kind of thing? They post a job board at ORU. I'd apply. I got hired at Fuller when I was in California. Yeah, they got job boards, you applied. And so one time I ended up working at a Nazarene church. And I don't want to say, Nazarenes have their good points, but they tend to be legalistic. They tend to be rules oriented. I was serving with the pastor of the church. One day I was at the DMV in California. I don't know if I was getting a license or a tag. And I ran into a gentleman who had been attending Peninsula Church of the Nazarene, but I hadn't seen him in a while. Now, he was a rather unique fellow, to be kind. He was just different. In a good strong wind, I think you could have flew him like a kite. He was tall and thin, and just didn't seem to have a muscle in his body. I don't know, he was just kind of unique. Now, Peninsula Church of the Nazarene had its Sunday morning service, and of course its Sunday night service, it's very traditional Nazarene type fare. And on Sunday nights, they'd ask if anybody had a testimony. Do you have any word that you want to share? And it was not uncommon for this gentleman to get up as he attended with his family and say something about he was thankful for God for this or for that, and he always had a good word to say. He was always there testifying for what God was doing on his behalf. And so I asked him, where have you been? Haven't seen you in a while. He looked me in the eye and said, the pastor asked me not to come back. The pastor was more about rules and regulations than he was about relationship. And the lifestyle of this guy didn't appear to have a job. His family was probably a little poor. I don't know what it was all about. I mean, he was a nice guy. But I was dumbfounded when I heard the pastor had literally asked him, don't come back. Because he didn't fit the image, he didn't fit the rules and regulations that the pastor thought he should fit. I mean, that was it. And this is where Jesus is coming down to the Pharisees. You've got your rules. You've got your regulations. You've got your rituals. You're doing all these things. But you're not building my kingdom. You're not showing grace. You're not demonstrating mercy. You're not showing forth faithfulness. All the things that were important. I have no idea what happened to that gentleman or to his family who had been attending faithfully for some time, but weren't anymore. I don't know if they decided to go to another church or if they just kind of, because of that experience, decided not to go to any church. How damaging it must be for somebody to be told not to come back to a church. This is what the Pharisees were doing. When you look at somebody here on Sunday morning, do you look at them and say, gee, they're a little different. They don't smell exactly like the rest of us do. Maybe they shouldn't be here. Or are you extending grace and mercy? When you get out in the world, out in this community, out in the mission field, are you showing forth those qualities and characteristics that would help people come to see Christ? Or are you doing things that are going to prevent them from coming to church? Are you going to set up a standard? Are you going to set up rules and regulations? Well, if you want to come to our church, you got to do these things. You can't do these things. You got to do these things. And if you do that, then you really don't want you. Whatever those things might be. Are we the ones who are supposed to clean up the people before they come to church? Are we the ones who even are supposed to clean up people in the church? So that's God's job. God will work on people as he chooses. He will guide and direct them. What's our responsibility? Love, kindness, gentleness. These are the things we're supposed to do. We're supposed to show forth the characteristics of God. Now, God will deal with those he has to deal with. But our responsibility is to provide those things that are greater. Let us not focus our attention on the minor things. Let us seek to always show forth the major things. I love the picture. Christ says, you strain out a gnat, yet you swallow a camel. He's talking about probably a glass of wine. They'll find a gnat floating on the wine. They'll strain it out. They'll get rid of it. But yet, there they go. They swallow the whole camel. They look for the minuscule things when they should be paying attention to the big things. And this is the challenge for us, to be people who go out into the community, wherever our vocation might take us, and deal with people with grace and mercy. Can't say that enough, because that's what God wants us to do, is to show forth his love. So if you're setting all those sorts of rules, You know the standard rules. Well, you know. You got to be in good clothes. Don't be dirty. Don't be smelly. Don't drink. Don't smoke. Whatever. If you're setting all those rules up, what are you doing? You're preventing people from coming in the church. Is there anyone that we should not let in our doors? Okay, yeah. Guys with guns. You know, unfortunately in our society, that's the first picture that comes into mind. Yeah, we're going to try to keep out those who would do us harm. But anyone who genuinely wants to come in and worship with us, they should be welcome. They should be welcome. I mean, that's it. Whatever their lifestyle, whatever their, you know, condition is, if they're coming here to find God, then we should allow them that privilege and that opportunity. We should not try to limit, regulate it, or, you know, prevent it. That's what the Pharisees did. The Pharisees were always looking for those little things. Well, you didn't tithe this week, so, you know, go home and tithe. No. Tithing is a great principle. And Christ says, no, we should not tithe. We should tithe. That's what Christ says. The principle is set long ago. It's the principle for us, you know. But there are things that are even more important than tithing. Now, Rochelle just had a heart attack because she counts the money. But you know what I'm saying here. We are the ones that can't be nitpicky. We're the ones that have to see the big picture and show forth those things that'll attract people to the kingdom of God, to His love, to His forgiveness, and hold that cross up high that God's Son might be magnified in our lives in all that we do. Now, as we compare these woes with the blessings, this is the fifth one we're on here, and the fifth beatitude is those who show mercy shall find mercy. But yes, here those who are bound by the law have no mercy to show. So if you don't have mercy, you won't find mercy. But if you show mercy, then you shall be given mercy. So let's work on our actions and our attitudes. Think of the little things in your life that might distract somebody. And work on focusing on those big things that'll bring people in. Not the minor, but the major. Not the law, but the gospel. Obedience unto Christ on the cross. For our life now, and for the life of all, forevermore. Amen. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Spirit be with you all.